All right. Very great day to everybody. It is a great day. It's an absolutely tremendous day. Now, let's say that someone comes to you and they say they're going to render a service to you, and they want payment in advance for the services they're going to render. So you say, okay, and you pay them. And then they come back later and they say, well, you know, it's a little more difficult than I thought. I need a little bit more. And you say, okay. And then they come back later and say, you know, it's really tough. Why don't we set up a payment schedule for you so that you can pay in advance? And then you say, well, okay. And then they come to you again and again and again and again. And you say, are you, you know, where's the service that you promised? Have you got it done yet? And they say, well, almost done. We just need a little more. That's belief. Belief is demanding payment of it from us in advance, like investors, to get the job done. Okay. The only problem is, and it's a big problem, is it will never get the job done. Okay, so all this payment we've been making is just pouring it down the drain, pouring it into a black hole. What's the payment? Our death. Death. Sickness, suffering. That's the payment we're making. Belief demands this of us. It comes to us, knocks on our door like a you know, debt collector, and says, hey, I need a little more from you. It's like you're an investor in a project, okay? And you're putting your money in, your capital, helping capitalize the venture. And it knocks on your door and says, hey, you're doing a great job, and here's the prospectus, blah, 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 and we're doing all this stuff, and we just need a little bit more investment from you. So we need for you to have an illness of some sort, and that will help greatly. And you say, oh, really? Wow, I'm really tired of suffering. Do you really need this? And he says, it's super important. You know, you don't know how important it is. You're a very special, integral part of the whole thing. And this, your illness is going to be a very key element. We'll plug that in, and it's going to be super helpful. And you say, wow, okay, I'll do it for the team. I'll do it for the effort. I'll do it for the cause. And so you do that. Eventually you get tired of being sick and paying such a heavy price, and you start, in my case, I start to investigate. I started to investigate Mr. Belief. Mr. Belief didn't like the investigation. And I said, what are you doing? Why are you asking these questions? I said, well, you know, it just, something doesn't seem quite right. You know, maybe you're just, you know, conning us, bilking us, demanding all this illnesses and deaths. I'm not sure that you're ever going to deliver on what you have to say. Well, of course, Belief went ballistic. Ballistic. So I've continued my investigations and into Mr. Belief, and I found out what I need to find out, you see. So it's a new, different ball game. It's a different ball game now. And I have advice to give to everybody on how to deal with the Mr. Belief, as when they knocks on your door and comes to collect your payment, I have advice. And I'll certainly be giving out that advice. And I've talked about a big boost coming. Well, I really feel it is coming. It is coming. In other words, it is justified for you to delay your payments to Mr. Belief. And you say, Mr. Belief, I'm not able to pay right now, but if you come, you'll have to come back later, and we'll discuss it later. And Belief says, later, you know, what? What are you talking about? I said, yeah, later. I says, oh, okay, but it'll be much more later. Okay, so in other words, Mr. Belief puts on interest on your payment, severe interest, usury. Says, wow, I'm only asking for an illness of the, you know, you can of this sort, but later it's going to be a really life-threatening illness if you don't pay now. So what you say, see, it's intimidating you that way. And what you say is, Well, we'll discuss that later. We'll discuss that later. We'll discuss the whole situation later. Belief doesn't like that. And Belief says, there will be no discussions later. You will pay later. And says, well, we'll discuss the issue of no discussions later also. That'll also be part of the discussion, you see. So Belief doesn't like that at all. But it has to leave. You know, say, I'm asking you to leave. Get off my property. I'm not paying. I'm not paying right now. So, as everybody's watching entertainment, television and movies and all this stuff, video games, you know, you name it, they're not learning how to deal with Mr. Belief when it comes knocking on your door asking for payment, asking for more investment. You know, the situation's going great, full steam ahead. But we need even more investment because this is a big project. What is the project? Of course, it is to intimidate reality and force reality to change, which is, of course, impossible. So it will never succeed. So everything, all our payments, all our investment is worthless. We've just poured it down. It's lost to no avail. But then, of course, why double down on futility, right? Cut your losses. Cut your losses. Say to Belief, Mr. Belief, not now, later. Come back later. We'll discuss the whole situation later. And in the meantime, you're getting wise to the situation. Now, those who are watching all this entertainment, how wise are they getting to the situation? And so when Mr. Belief comes knocking on their door and says, it's time for your payment, they say, well, what are you talking about? Really, it's time? And Belief says, yeah, it's time. And you don't want to wait because later it'll be a lot more, so you really need to do it now. And they'll say, oh my gosh, I don't want to die. Do I have to die? And Belief says, yeah, but it's a small price to pay. Just think of what you're going to get from it, you know. Wow. And Mr. Belief says, I promise you, I won't ask any more from you. Just this death, that's all. Does Mr. Belief keep that promise? I can tell you for sure it does not. It does not. It comes knocking at your door in the afterlife too and says, you know what, the situation is so far advanced in now that I'm calling on all my heavy investors, my special investors who have supported this thing through thick and thin for so long. I'm calling on you to give one more big investment, big boost to the situation, right? And It's gonna work. I'm telling you for sure it's gonna work. I promise you it's gonna work. And you say, oh my God, I don't want to go back to the world and have another go around here. It's terrible. But if you really promise that this is it, then I will make the supreme sacrifice and do that. And Mr. Belief says, you don't know what a great thing you're doing. So you're back in the world, and then Belief comes knocking on your door and says, now that you're here, you know, we need to get as much as possible, you know, investment out of you as possible. So we really need you to be very sick here. Now, the big boost that I'm talking about is a different big boost. It's the big boost of saying no to Mr. Belief, you see. That is where it's all at. Because the no is not just no for now, it is no forever. It is not just no for this body, monkey suit, meat suit. It is no for the afterlife, too. No, you're not coming back, you see. It's the big no. Is the big boost because it's the big no to Belief. But here's the situation. If you try and say that now, you know, all the way, no forever, Belief's going to get very angry and say, I'll tell you what, I'll cut a deal with you. I will never ask you for any more investment if you just give me your death this one last time. Then I promise I'll never bother you again. So, of course it's going to play that card, and you just say, no deal, Mr. Belief. Who can say that, you see? Because Belief seems to offer you a great deal. It says, I'll never knock on your door again. Of course, that's a lie, but it offers this on the table, that I'll never knock on your door again. So, the big boost is to say, no deals, come back later. We'll discuss it later. Now, later means you have an opportunity to clarify the situation. So I've been doing that for a long time. Later, 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 because belief is always knocking on my door saying, pay up, pay up. It's always throwing illnesses my way and troubles and even near deaths. A lot. Near accidents, near deaths is just pathetic. You know, it keeps saying, hey, here's an opportunity to pay what you owe me. And I say, no, later. It says, but this was a real good one. Nobody will blame you. It was an accident. I say, it wasn't no accident. You arranged the entire thing. I know it's not an accident. Really, my belief has arranged some very clever accidents for me. At the last second, I stepped out of the way. And it's shocked. Belief was shocked. He said, what? It was perfect. Perfect setup. No one would ever know. They wouldn't blame you for it. And I say, no. There was a setup. I could see it entirely, very clearly. So I've been telling belief later, 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 and getting time to clarify. And that's given me the opportunity to see that belief is simply taking all this from us, our sicknesses, our struggles, our traumas, our deaths, as payment for a service that it claims it's going to render later, but it's never going to render that service. So it's, everything has been under false pretenses. Entirety of existence has been under false pretenses from the very beginning. Now, there's a very important way to look at this whole situation. You could say, and this is quite accurate, that all of the suffering, all of existence, all of this entire situation is the troubles we expect to arise once we graft effects from one idea onto another idea. Okay. In other words, we have this plan that we want to do called duality. We have this plan that we, you know, and we have a plan to be prime creator. And the way we're doing it is we're trying to reverse the direction of cause and effect. And the way we're trying to do that is take effects from one idea and graft them onto the effects of another idea. So what we're doing here is we're anticipating the problems that we believe will arise from this grafting. And we are, in anticipation of these, we are modeling the problems we expect and working, trying to find ways to fix these problems that we believe will arise from a situation that has not yet taken place. So the truth is that right now there's absolutely nothing wrong with us. We're not sick, we're not dying, we're not vulnerable. There's absolutely nothing wrong with us actually right now. This entire scenario of existence is a modeling, a hypothetical scenario where we're modeling the problems that we anticipate will arise and finding ways to fix them ahead of time. We think, wow, this is very smart. We're very smart. We're not going to wait for those problems to hit us. We're going to have it all worked out ahead of time. But the situation is that we'll never be able to graft effects from one idea onto another idea. So none of these problems will ever arise. So all this modeling we're doing in anticipation of fixing all these problems is a waste of time, a complete waste of time. There's nothing wrong with us right now. We're flawless right now. But we're imagining ourselves to be having all these problems because those are the problems we expect will beset us. Temporarily, we think, we believe that temporarily, but we have to find a way to fix these problems. Once we find a way to fix these problems, then we'll feel confident to graft effects from one idea onto another idea, another causation. That's it. So, really, in the final analysis, this Mr. Belief who's demanding all the sacrifices from us, the sicknesses and death and so on, that's just, it's in our employee. It's an employee. We're using that to get all these problems and difficulties, etc. You know, the sicknesses and vulnerabilities and stuff, so that then we can work on them. Okay, what do we do in the afterlife? Well, we work on, why did we die? You know, work on the lessons, you know, integrating the lessons that we learned from our previous life and our death, and why did we die in the sicknesses, and we're supposed to, you know, these are life lessons, you know, that we're supposed to be learning, all that kind of stuff. It's supposed to be like super important, you know, you have to go through this. Belief is demanding it of us. Belief is this one who makes these demands of us, who's very, very tricky, very slippery, full of lies, and comes and says, you have to pay. Okay, you have to. It's time for you to make this next payment. You know, you have to do it. Because there's this great cause we're engaged in, that we're modeling the problems we're going to have. So you have to play along with this modeling exercise, you know. And you might say, well, you know, I'm really not sick at all. You know, this is just, I'm just imagining, pretending to be sick, really. Actually, all of existence is a pretense, entirely. We're only pretending all of this. None of us is sick. None of us ever died. None of us was ever born. You were never born into existence. But we're modeling, we're pretending that we've been born, so that we can then pretend we have all these problems, so that we can pretend to fix all these problems, so we'll know how to fix the big problem when we graft effects from one causation onto another causation, that we'll be able to fix the problems that we anticipate arising at that point. The answer to this whole situation is that we'll never be able to graft effects from one causation onto another cause, another causation, never be able to do it. So the problems will never arise. So we don't need to know how to fix problems that will never arise. So when belief comes knocking, you know, you can just tell it the jig's up, you know, the game is up. I'm not paying you ever. You know, and if you say, I'm not paying you ever, of course belief will say, okay, I'll make you a deal. And just one more death and then no more payment forever. And you have to be able to dismiss that as well. It doesn't go easily, belief, because it's in your employ, and it's a born liar, and it's a marketer of sickness and dying and death and trauma and misfortune and loss and vulnerability and threat. And it demands that you continue the pretense. And your pretending is so, you know, so strong, you will pretend to die. And of course, you'll pretend the body is dead and in the ground and decayed, and you'll pretend that you're in the afterlife, and you'll pretend the whole thing continues on and on. But really, none of this has ever happened to any of us. There's never been any trauma, there's never been any sickness, never been any death. No aspect of spirit has ever suffered in the slightest bit. It's all a pretense. From a pragmatic standpoint, we have to deal with that. You know, we can talk about the theoretical, which is the ultimate stand up to belief and dismissing it, you know, firing it, you know, firing belief. How do you fire belief? Choose a new idea. Give up the idea of modeling problems, of trying to be prime creator, of needing to fix the problems that will arise from that. Give up that causation. Choose a new causation. The idea of not trying to change, be prime creator, not trying to change reality. And then no more belief. No belief to come knocking on your door at all at that point. But pragmatically at this point, there has to be ways for you to, until you get to that point of being able to dismiss the whole thing, choose a new idea, which is the goal that everyone has to reach. But in the meantime, belief is knocking on your door demanding your death, you see? And you have to be able to stand up to it and say, not now, later. That's what I've done. I said later, 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 later. I said, if you want payment, go to my guru, go to my teacher, they'll pay you. So they go to the guru, and the guru says, sure, I'll pay you at some point. Come back later. We'll discuss the payment at that time. It's just humoring belief. You know, the guru knows how to humor belief that way, knowing that this is all pretense. So you can just send belief to your attorney, as it were, to your guru, to your attorney. Say, go take it up with them if you got a problem with it. But belief, you know, threatens us with usury. You know, like, well, I'll come back later, but it's going to be way more expensive. And you just have to say, well, we'll take up that issue also at a later date. So when it comes back at a later date, it says, okay, I'm here for the payment, and I'm here for the interest on the payment too, high interest. And you say, well, I'm not prepared to pay any of that at this point, but come back later and we'll discuss the whole situation at that time. And then belief will say, you're crazy, because the interest is going to go skyrocket. It's compounding like crazy. you're really stupid. You're making a very bad mistake. And you say, well, you come back at a later date and we'll discuss the entire situation of whether I'm crazy or not, and the payments and the interest and the whole thing, the whole ball of wax. We'll discuss that later. Don't worry about that. We'll schedule it. You know, no problem. Of course, it takes great confidence to do that. But you can do that. Now, initially, you know, you have to say, come back a little later, and you're kind of nervous about it. You know, you don't know how to stand up to belief exactly. So you may just say, well, I'll pay a little bit, a little less. You might start off by saying, I'm going to pay a little less. In other words, the illness is not so bad. That's what I did. I'll pay a little less, a little less. Diminish your payments as you gradually gain strength to stand up to belief. And eventually you say, no, I'm not paying today. Come back later. And then the great game is on, you know. And you keep postponing belief, and belief says, wow, you know, you are following a really dangerous road here, because you know the interest is accruing at such a terrible rate. I'm telling you that as your friend, I'm telling you should pay now and not later. It's better for you. And you say, look, we'll discuss the whole issue of whether you're my friend or not, whether the interest is justified or not, whether I'm going to pay or not, etc. We'll do that at a later date, and you know, not now. As you get more and more clarity and to stand up to belief, realizing, wait a minute, this whole thing is a con game. I mean, this whole thing is a scam. It's completely unnecessary. It's useless. It's a pretending. It's a pretense. All this investment of death and suffering and vulnerability that I've given, it has been useless. But the good news is it was just a pretense. That's never happened to me at all. I'm flawless. Nothing's ever happened to what I am. What I am has always remained as it is. And still is with me. It's in my house, as a matter of fact. I'm just telling it to don't let belief see you, you know. It's hidden. It's in the upper room, you know, saying, I don't want Mr. Belief to see you, because Mr. Belief will, like, really get upset about that. And, you know, I want Mr. Belief to like me so he won't charge me so much interest. So many people are in appeasement mode, where they're trying to appease belief and saying, wait a second, I'm getting somebody coming here. One second. Maybe that's Mr. Belief.
Wait a sec. Wait a minute.
Maybe it wasn't Mr. Belief, maybe it was Mrs. Belief. Yeah. So, you have the true self, what I am, is in the upper room. Belief comes, not Mr. Belief, or Mrs. Belief comes knocking at your door. And you say, oh my gosh, I don't want them to see, you know, this. They might get upset, and I'm in negotiations. I want them to like me. You know, I want them to like me more. And if they find out I've been listening to this, you know, what I am, truth, they might get very upset and demand full payment of me right now, because they'll feel like I'm starting to stand up to them. And they might say, they might get very angry and say, I want your death right now, because they feel threatened. Which this concern is justified, because they might very well do that. Belief might very well say, uh-oh, this one is starting to get resistance to me. I better demand the full payment right now. So we are kind of don't want the two to meet. We don't want belief in what we are to meet, feeling that it'll go bad for us. Well, it won't, because the truth knows how to handle belief. And we'll just say, belief, look, the jig is up, the game is up, it's over. But we don't realize that. So we try not to let belief know that we're listening to truth. You see, we don't want belief to know it. Afraid of angering belief. Belief will get really angry at us and say, hey, maybe you're thinking I'm not paying me ever, huh? And say, well, I'll tell you what. Just say, I'll tell you what, belief, you come back later and we'll discuss that issue, or whatever issues you want to discuss is fine, but we'll do that a little later. And it'll stomp off in a fury, you know, because it's feeling like, hey, maybe you're not going to pay. Maybe you're not going to pay, you see. It's feeling threatened. It doesn't know why. If it feels threatened, like you're getting weird on it, you know, and doesn't like that. So that's a situation like I'm in. That there's truth, you know. Truth is right there. I'm talking with truth, and then belief comes knocking on my door, and I say, "Oh gosh, what do I do? I don't want them belief to know that truth is right here with me." Oh my, you know, what is it gonna do? It's gonna freak out. So it's a little awkward. But we have to go over the awkwardness of it and keep our cool. And you can just introduce, say, Mr. Belief, I'd like you to meet what I am. Meet I am. Yeah, meet I am. I am. And Belief will probably say, I don't want to meet them. Forget it. I'll come back later. But when I come back, I'm really, really, we're really going to have to, you know, get down to the payment here. Okay, I say, okay, come back later if you want to. It's okay. That's probably what happens is belief will just stomp out the door and say, well, when you get, I don't like your friend, when you get rid of your friend, I'm going to come back and we're going to get down to a bit real business here, because you giving signs that you might not be honoring your payment schedule, and we're going to have to iron that stuff out and correct your attitude. I say, whatever, come on back then when, you know, yeah, you can come back when I am is not here. But, of course, the fact is, I am is always going to be here. So, you know, there you go. You've seen the last of Mr. Belief at that point, when you get to that point. And it's just, you know, it's putting belief off, which has to be done. Saying, no payment now, no payment now. And so that's the end game, is that belief will leave and say that it's coming back in with all powers. Says, you know what? It'll say, you know what? I've been really nice to you up till now, because you've been really good to me, and we've had a good relationship. A payment, you've been paying on time, and we've had some troubles, and but I'm willing to forgive all those troubles. You know, you've been kind of a troublesome debtor, and I've had a lot of troubles with you, and we know that, but I'm willing to say it's all water under the bridge. If you just tell that crazy roommate of yours to leave, because, you know, I just don't feel comfortable around them, you know. I think I'm going to file a lawsuit. If you don't, I'm going to file a lawsuit. I'm going to call it spiritual harassment. I feel uncomfortable. I feel like I'm being harassed by I am. You know, and so But if you get IAM to leave, I'm willing to turn the page, blank slate, Jubilee, all that, you know, debt's forgiven, we'll start all over, fresh start, everything, you know, I'm willing to cut a deal with you. And you say, well, whoa, really, wow. He says, but if you don't, I'm coming back with all the legal might and power, and I'm going to sue you, and the payments, you don't know, you're going to have hell to pay, because really, I'm not happy with, you know, the fact that you even have this IAM in your house. How can you have this IAM crazy nutcase in your house that doesn't seem to be as carefree and doesn't seem to understand the gravity of your situation, doesn't seem to understand the greatness of the cause we're engaged in. It doesn't, you know, this, you know, you're hanging around with very bad influences. This is terrible. And you have to get rid of this bad influence. Otherwise, I'm going to, you know, start filing the briefs and look out. Look out. You're going to be in big trouble. And you have to say, okay, listen, I'll tell you what. You come on back a little later and we'll discuss this entire situation. And Belief says, you always say that. I say, well, you know, hey, I'm saying it again. And we'll discuss whether you're going to, you know, these lawsuits and this harassment claims and the usury and the interest and the severity. We'll discuss the whole ball of wax a little bit later. But you have to leave now, because IAM is not going anywhere. At this point, it's not going anywhere. So you see, it is getting down to hardball right now. You can feel that it's a hardball situation, because Belief is feeling like you're putting the squeeze on it. It's not used to this, you know. It says, in all my dealings with all the debtors and all the investors, let's say, because it's more like investors. In all my dealings with all the investors, I've never come across anyone, not a single one, that's given me trouble like you're giving me, you know. Or maybe there's been some. Actually, they'll say, you know what? You're starting to sound like some of those terrible turncoat trader investors, the few of them that have completely lost their opportunity to have any success whatsoever. And they're doomed to all eternity. And you're really seeming to go down that very bad road. And I'm talking to you as an advisor, you know. You don't dare go down that road. That's hardball, you know. Belief puts the screws to you. So, you might wonder, why watch these videos? Why engage in inquiry? Because Belief knows how to play hardball. That is why. I used to play wiffle ball when I was young. And then I got into, you know, using softballs and, you know, rubber balls, softballs, various things. Eventually, I start playing hardball, and I realized that this is a whole different game. You know, the hardball is a different game than wiffle ball, or even softball. I mean, you know, you have to feel your position. You've got to protect yourself at all times. You have to know how to feel your position. You have to know how to handle the throws. You have to know how to do it. Otherwise, you're going to get hurt. And you have to know how to get out of the way of a pitch. I mean, you know, the ball is hard. It's coming fast. So, Belief knows how to play hardball. It's an expert. And it will play hardball with you. So you have to get some exposure to the hardball, the whole situation here, you know. And you get it by listening to those who are in the game, in playing hardball with Belief, because they'll tell you about it, and you start to get the lay of the land. You get the feeling, aha, wow, and you start to see how to play hardball with Belief, and how to put off, you know, the investment that's demanding of you, and to stand up to Belief, and how to do it gradually, and it'll keep, you know, ratcheting up its tactics on you, of course. And you have to continually stay a step ahead. Otherwise, it's going to, you know, offer all these deals. They say, you know what? I've got all these payments you need to make into the future. You've got so many you need to make. But I'm going to make a deal with you, and you don't have to pay. I'm gonna forgive a lot of these payments. Is it going now? I'm going to forgive a lot of these payments in the future if you make a payment right now. It'll say that. That's hardball, right? It'll say, look, you've got all these deaths and sicknesses in the future, all this karma, and I'll tell you what, I'll forgive a lot of that karma if you make a big payment to me right now. It will say that. Definitely will say that. And you have to be able to say, no deal. We'll talk about that deal later. And can you do that is the question. Because then it'll say, hey, you're incurring a lot of really bad karma because I need your investment right now. It's super important right now. If you don't do it right now, you are refusing, you're not being compassionate, you're being selfish, unloving, non-compassionate, you're trying to separate yourself from the wholeness, from the oneness, except blah, blah, blah. It'll lay a total guilt trip on you, you know. And you have to be able to stand up to that and say, no, we'll discuss the whole thing, this guilt, blah, 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 how bad I am, we'll discuss it later. We'll deal with the whole situation a little later. And you will deal with it, the whole situation, a little later. It's not a lie. You will deal with the whole situation later. And you'll deal with it by choosing a new idea. Realization, you're realizing that the entire thing is just a pretense. That's how you deal with it. So you're not telling a lie to believe at all. You said, just say, I'll deal with the entire situation a little later. But the hardball that it plays in various ways, you know, is very nasty stuff. Again, that karmic thing, you know, is one of the ways that it one of the deals it offers you, and it will carrot and stick. If you accept the deal, you know, you think, wow, I will have lessened my time, my investment schedules by significantly, and I'll finally be, you know, free of misery and dying and suffering and rebirth, etc. But if I don't do it, I will have extended the time significantly, you know, and you think, wow, got to make this deal. It's crazy not to. Well, I'll tell you, I'm not making that deal for sure. I'm not making it. So there's at least one of your brothers is not making that deal at all. I've seen through it completely. It's nothing but a scam, because the goal that this investment is supposed to help reach will never be reached. So what can belief do except tell you have more karma to burn off, and you have to be reborn again to do it. More investment, in other words, more investment. It's all pretense. All karma is a pretense. This whole thing is a pretense. All of existence, all good karma, all bad karma, all a pretense. All a pretense is all it is. You don't have any karma. What you are right now has no karma. Never will ever have any. How could you? How can you accrue karma in reality where there's absolutely nothing in reality that can be harmed or threatened in any way? Can anyone answer that question? Can ask belief that? Can belief answer that question? And belief cannot answer that question. Cannot. Reality is invulnerable. Nothing real can be threatened. Therefore, how could any karma accrue to anyone? Is the question, right? How could it? Even a tiny bit? The answer is it cannot. So how can you have karma? The answer is you don't. You don't have any. Nobody has any karma. We're pretending that we will have karma to burn off once we make this switch of effects, this dualistic, you know, grafting. We're pretending that we will have massive karma to burn off, and we're trying to figure out ways to burn it off. But the fact is we will never do that. So we won't ever have any massive karma. We won't ever have any karma to burn off. So when belief offers you this deal, say, I'm going to burn off a lot of your karma if you pay the price of dying sacrifice right now, give me that investment of your death right now. You say, no deal, no deal, no deal. You'll say, well, don't say no deal. Say, we'll talk about that deal a little later. We'll talk about the whole thing a little later. That's all you have to say. You don't even have to say no deal. You say, we'll talk about the whole situation a little bit later. And of course, that gives you, buys you time to recognize you don't have any karma in the first place. Which means, what is this talk about a deal? It's absolute nonsense. Total nonsense. Which is why my whole life I've been very adamant. There's no such thing as karma. It's total nonsense. And I knew there's something, you know, how could karma start in the first place? It's impossible. It's impossible. Totally impossible. And those who talk about this, they don't know what they're talking about, really. Of course, there's some gurus who bring it up because people believe in it so much. But what they say is, hey, you know, let's deal with this karma a little later. So they play the game. They say, hey, let's all talk about this a little later. People are not ready to hear that there's no such thing as karma. They're not ready for it. You know, you're in kindergarten. You have to teach the kindergartners at the level where they're at. You have to kind of, you know, humor them. You know, gurus humor people here. Believe me, they humor. And if you don't need humoring, they won't humor you. But if you do, they'll humor you. They'll humor you, just like you humor a child, you know, who's maybe kind of silly, being kind of silly. So you cannot take what gurus say in this world entirely. Take it with a grain of salt because they talk differently to everybody, depending on how much someone needs to be humored, okay? So you can't take what they say to one person and apply it to someone else. Because someone else, they may say something entirely different. One of my gurus, Ananda Mahamashi, said different stuff to everybody. She said, what I say to one person is different what I say to another one. And everyone is unique. She says, I don't have any teaching, universal teaching for everybody here. Because everybody requires a different type of teaching based on where they're at. So she would give teaching privately to each one and say, don't discuss what I said to you to anyone else. Because it's meant for you only. And if you discuss with someone else will say, oh, she told me something different, you know, and then you'll get all confused. So, sure, some gurus talk about karma. Some gurus are not real gurus at all, and they're just, you know, Mr. and Mrs. Belief demanding sacrifice of you, and so they'll talk about karma to scare you and, you know, demand that you payment. Whereas the real gurus might talk about karma, but for me, I dismiss karma altogether. I said, this is nonsense. Always, this is complete nonsense, total nonsense. It's all pretense. Okay, so you don't have any karma. Nobody has any karma. Why? Because nothing real can be threatened. And nothing unreal exists. So how can what is real accrue karma? It's impossible. If it can't be harmed in any way, cannot deprive anyone of anything. Reality is all in all. Every aspect of reality has all of reality. No one can be deprived of anything. No, nothing can be harmed, nothing can be threatened. There's absolutely no basis for karma accruing whatsoever. None, zero, and never will be. So there's no such thing as karma. So when beliefs makes this deal with karmic deal with you, we say, wait a minute, let's talk about this later. We'll discuss the whole thing later. And right now, you got to leave me. Leave me in peace, get out of my door. And then you spend your time clarifying this whole situation. So when belief comes back later and says, okay, we're going to deal with the whole thing, you say, well, you know what, I guess we're going to discuss this and any other demands you have a little bit later. And then belief says, I'm going to have a lot more demands. Say, oh, that's fine. You bring them a little bit later. We'll discuss everything. The whole ball of wax we'll discuss later. Just do that. That is really the way. It's the best way. It is the best way. And a belief says, well, I'll give you a peak experience. If you just agree to invest, I'm going to give you a peak experience. Say, okay, we will discuss this whole deal thing later. This peak experience deal, the karmic deal, whole thing, whole ball of wax, a little bit later. We'll discuss it all a little bit later. And you will. You're not lying. And you'll tell a belief later, there's no such thing as karma. And what you asked me to invest in, that goal will never be reached. So the investment is complete folly and futility, and there's no need for it. It's meaningless. No need for it anymore. It's all. And as a matter of fact, this entire thing has been nothing but pretense. Nothing ever happened to what I am, and nothing ever will happen to what I am. So the game is up. That is the whole ball of wax. That is a little talk you'll have with belief at some point. So simply say, well, whatever belief throws at you, just say, we'll discuss that and anything else you want to bring up a little bit later. That's completely valid, completely valid. And it's honest. It's honest and it's valid. Because you have every right to do that. It's your will, after all. You're the investor, right? Belief is just using your capital. Belief doesn't have any capital of its own. Belief can't do anything of its own accord. Nothing. Because belief is nothing. Because the goal is nothing. It has nothing to give you. Nothing to offer you. Just promises. That's it. Empty promises. So you're in charge. You're the one who chose the idea of being prime, wanting to be prime creator in the first place, not belief. Belief didn't choose that. Belief's not a free agent. You're the one who decides. You're the one who's pretending, this whole pretense, not belief. The pretense is not causing the pretense. Spirit's causing the pretense. So you can say, come back later, we'll discuss it later, and belief can do nothing except try to intimidate you, but that's it. That's all it can do. So these deals, you know, this threats, first it'll threaten you with interest, and when that doesn't work, then it switches over to a deal, you know, making this deal. And then it'll switch over to guilt, like you're hurting somebody, but it's, you know, no, you're not. You're showing them the way. There's only the way to be, choose a new idea. It's the only way. So you're showing them the only way there is. It's all a pretense. What is the way in of the whole situation is to drop your pretense. That's the only way. So you're showing them the only way that there is. So that's not hurting them in any way. You're showing them how to stand up to belief and say, not now, later. So no one's being hurt by that at all. So the guilt, first there's the, you know, the threat that it's going to make it worse for you, demand more investment later. That threat, one second here, again somebody's coming. Interesting. Okay. I was asked to do something previously. The previous situation, I was asked to do something, and I said, okay, I'll do it, but not now, a little later. Okay? And they said, okay. And now I just hear that, oh, don't worry, it's already been done, so you don't have to do it. Perfect example. Just what we're talking about. Perfect example. Okay, now, the guilt factor that belief will run on you is say, well, because you're not investing, somebody else that has to invest more. They'll lay that guilt on you. And I say, well, theoretically you might think that way, but the fact is, but by seeing through the pretense entirely and realizing there's no such thing as karma, you then become a genuine teacher, you know, and the assurance, the certitude that you have affects everyone. And everyone gets a boost in being able to stand up to the bully of belief. So when the bully belief comes to someone else and says, I'm demanding more payment of you because this one didn't pay, everyone's going to be able to say, well, maybe, but we'll talk about that a little bit later. You know, so actually, it does not make the payment more severe for anyone else at all. That's a lie, another lie of belief. It makes the situation better because they can stand up a little better to belief. A little better, maybe not entirely. And belief says, I'm going to bully them real bad. But belief cannot work that way. Belief has to be careful. Belief has to be careful, you see. So what belief says, eventually it will force more payment from them. But as people get better and better at standing up to the bully belief, they keep postponing. They eventually realize that they don't have to pay anything to belief. So it's all a bluff. Belief is simply bluffing. Guilt is a bluff. If it's unexamined, it may seem legitimate, but it's examine it, and you see it's not true. Doesn't make things more difficult. Doesn't demand more payment from others. Belief is bluffing. It says it will at some point, but just not now, and not ever. You know, because the certitude remains. Anyone in this world who has a certitude about the situation—that's all pretense. Anyone. that has this realization, lightens the load for everyone else because it boosts their confidence and assurance a little bit, all the way around. It's shared with everyone, you know. And everyone takes whatever assurance they can get from that. Some take a little bit, some take a lot. So, you know, I got assurance from various teachers, from a lot of different sources, actually. Not just the ones I mentioned, but a lot of different ones. I just got the most assurance from like Ananda Maima, who, you know, was like flawless certainty, totally flawless certitude. And it's like a big boost. I said, wow. You know, she can stand up to belief. She just doesn't. He's not the slightest bit intimidated by any deal that belief tries to run, any trick. Nothing, doesn't fade in the slightest bit. Not even as amazing, totally amazing. And I just said, wow, it's possible. You know, it's possible. Really, is possible. And then, of course, Jesus Christ, and 2,000 years ago, and also in A Course in Miracles, showed how conceptually you can stand up to belief, ideologically, conceptually, and shows how you can clarify the whole thing and put belief off, you know, how to gain the clarity to stand up to belief. Show me it is possible. He's just saying, showing, hey, look, you know, you need a belief system, a conceptual system, you're used to it. So here's a way to use concepts and words in a way to clarify. I said, that's fabulous, absolutely fabulous. So you get reassurance from those who have done it. And even if you're not aware of them, that certitude is in the world. It reverberates. You know, it's like all sounds ever been in the world are still reverberating, however faintly, right? They have effects. Reverberation causes, you know, effects everywhere. Everything is like that. So certitude here has its own reverberation and echoing. You know, we can catch those echoes. We catch those echoes, no question about it. I was able to, you know, catch those echoes because I wanted to stand up to belief. I said, there's something fishy going on here. And I started catching that reverberation. And I found out the source of the reverberations. I said, there's some powerful, powerful certitude reverberating in this world. You know, just recently I realized, I said, where is it coming from? Where is it? And I finally tracked it down to Ananda Maima. I knew that there was someone, you know, had been in this world that was incredibly powerful and certain. I just didn't know who. I said, where's this coming from? I don't know. And then also I knew that A Course in Miracles was going to come into the world. I knew that ahead of time. And then I was able to, I knew it was in the world. I couldn't find it. I said, I know it's somewhere. And then in 1978, I came across it in a bookstore. And right away I said, oh my gosh, I think this is it. And I read it a little bit and I said, this is it. Powerful, powerful stuff. Really helps you stand up to belief. And meaning, say not now to belief, not now, a little later. We'll deal with the whole ball of wax a little later. Whatever you want to deal with, we'll talk about a little later. And belief fly says, no, I want to talk about it right now. And says, well, you're out of luck. It's going to be later because I got other stuff I'm going to do. I need some, you know, clarifications I need to make here. I'm not prepared yet to discuss the whole ball of wax. And belief will say, well, you don't need to discuss the whole ball of wax. We'll just, you know, get into a little bit and say, no, but I want to discuss the whole thing with you. See, there's another thing you need to know. You got to say, I want to discuss the entire ball of wax with you. And so I'm not ready to do that yet. I want to make the whole payment. Whatever, I want to be finished with you. Whatever that is, finishing is, we want to be finished. So let's do that later. Not prepared yet. And belief will say, offer you a deal. Say, wait a minute. Let's do part now and part later. Say, no, I want to take care of the whole thing all at once. The whole thing all at once. And the value of these great teachers is that they tell you that you need to take care of the whole thing all at once. Don't try to deal with belief bit by bit. No, put it off and say, we'll do the whole thing all at once, and they ensure us you can. But dealing with it all at once means realizing this whole thing is just a pretense, and what you are has never been born. It's never been harmed in any way, and you have no karma. getting rid of karma is a realization that you never had any karma. That's how you get rid of karma. How you pay off karma is realizing you never had any in the first place. But until you get to that point, trust the teachers and tell you to postpone the payment of it. Put it off and deal with it all at once. That's the way. Don't listen to belief when it tells you you can do a little now, a little later. No, 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 no. Because then you get into starting making deals with belief and you'll be in big trouble. So, you know, it seems audacious to say I'll pay it all off at once. And people say, you're crazy, you know. It's better to make payments bit by bit. I'll say, I'll tell you what. Whatever I have to pay, I will pay later. Whatever it is. But that's yet to be determined. I want to find out first what it is I really have to pay here. And that belief is telling me, I this is what I have to pay. And I say, well, I want to be sure about that. I don't want to underpay you. Tell that to belief. I don't want to underpay you. Maybe I need to pay you more, you know. Maybe I need to invest even more. I want to find out for sure. And belief doesn't like that. It says, oh, no, 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 no. I know how much you have to pay. Trust me, trust me. I say, well, I trust you, but I want to verify it. So now I'm going to verify all this. Because, you know, I'm getting, some of these teachers have been telling me stuff that sounds pretty accurate, you know, and I need to be sure that, you know, if they're accurate or not. And belief says, well, you know, yeah, just say they're accurate and let's just go on with this right now. Say, no, 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 I want to be sure about the whole thing. Let's be fair. Let's be honest to all parties involved here. What's wrong with that? So in other words, be true to yourself and your honesty. And you say, I want to be honest to all parties, which you do. And you want to be sure that you're honest. And you feel, to say, belief, I feel like, you know, I'm not at ease with making a deal at this point. I want to know. You know, I don't want to just believe I'm being fair and honest. I want to know I'm being fair and honest here. So I'm not quite yet at that point that we can make the, you know, make a deal. And, you know, that's the battle. That's the battle on the path, is putting off belief, putting off payment. Because whatever karma you're paying for is just a pretense. It's a fake, because no one's ever been harmed. No aspect of reality's ever been harmed. So how did you get any karma? You didn't. Everything here is a pretense. It's a pretending. It's a willful pretending. All death is a pretense. All everything here is a pretense. It's a pretending. Again, I'll use a story from one of my teachers. There was a situation where apparently those who were close to Anandamayi at one point apparently wanted her to be dead. I guess they're very angry with her because she wouldn't make any deals or something. And belief within them said, hey, this one here, you know, would be better off if she were dead. And what happened was she dropped to the floor like she had suddenly died. And there's no heartbeat, no breathing, nothing. And then she rapidly her body started to discolor in the putrid greens and yellows like a rotting corpse. And she turned into a rotting corpse right in front of their eyes. And they're absolutely, completely freaked out. And they were so shocked by this, apparently they told belief that they couldn't deal with belief right now. This was like a crisis, they had to come back later. And making that decision, tell belief, you have to come back later, I don't want her to die, this is horrible. They really want her to die. And by seeing the pretense that they wanted from her, she gave it to him. And they realized, oh my gosh, I want her to die, now I don't really want that, come back to life. She came back to life. Coloration came back. The heart started again. The breathing started. And she eventually got up. And she was like in completely perfect, flawless health. That's a fact. Many witnesses to that. And it happened on several occasions, actually. Different degrees of it. But even to the degree of the corpse was rotting. Stinking and rotting. Like a putrid corpse in front of them. Because she knew it was all pretense. So if you want to pretend, she says, I'll go along with your pretense. Death is a pretense. And she showed him, it's just a pretense. That's it. You're just pretending. It's the will to pretend causes the death of the body and the rotting of the body and all of that. All of nature is a pretense. Everything in existence is pretending. And so they had to be very careful around her, because if they wanted her to pretend something, she would. Pretend that she has cancer, she pretended she had cancer. And it got so bad that they were sure she was going to die within the night, and they were wanting to give her, you know, shots of morphine for the pain, and she said, no, no. And apparently at some point, this video is jumping around, at some point, I guess they decided, no, we don't want any more of that, you know, no more pretending to have cancer. And boom, like that, boom. Cancer metastasized everywhere in her body, tumors everywhere, boom, was gone in an instant. In an instant. That's again a fact. Medical doctors attested to this fact. Those who were attending to her. Some incredibly advanced, horrific cancer was gone in an instant. Disappeared. They saw her the next morning, there was not a trace of it. These are prominent MDs testified to this fact. These people were prominent people, educated people, actually. This is not myth or superstition of, you know, not at all. And it's a fact. All this is absolute fact. Just showing it's all pretense. All pretense. Again, her weight situations, many situations where she just pretended it. And when someone dropped the need for a pretense, it was gone. And there are times when people would drop the need to pretend that she, to see that she was pretending to be a body, the body pretense, and they wouldn't even see her body at all. They'd see some radiant, incredible light radiance, no body even there at all. Or if there was a crisis where they needed to lift her on a train, and there's no way to pull her on because it was like a desperate situation, the pretense of weight, she dropped that. There'd be no desire for weight, and so she dropped the pretense of weight, and whoosh, light as a feather. It was complete pretense. In fact, her appearance here was just pretense. And she knew it. She'd say, that's what it is. That's all it is. Nothing but pretense. Because you wanted it. So by seeing these things, you know, by seeing these so-called miracles of great ambassadors of certitude, you get clued in. You say, wait, whoa, 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 what's going on here? What's going on here? You know. And, you know, she never asked anyone to worship her as a God. Not at all. She says, no, 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 no. There's only one God. God is all. All in all. And it's just everything. All. The all is God. Because it's all in all. It's all one. These aren't, you know, these aren't miracles. These are just dropping the pretense. It means it's your willingness to drop the pretense. Remember, Jesus said, your faith made you whole. And he said, oh, you cured me. He said, no, 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 no. Your faith made you whole. Meaning you drop, you're willing to drop the pretense for a moment of that you have some kind of karma you need to pay through the, your sickness. You dropped it for a moment, and the blind can see. Of course, anything can happen instantly. There's no such thing as any illness that can't be healed instantly. No such thing. Even death, you can be rotting in the ground, and that can be healed instantly. Theoretically, the resurrection could take place. Where you drop all pretense that you ever died in the first place. But of course, if you drop that pretense, why? What do you need a body for? Okay, let's be honest about that. Why would you resurrect a body of flesh when you realize that the body of flesh is nothing but a pretense to try and anticipate problems that will never arise in the first place? So it's rather fanciful. It could happen, of course, but why? Why would anyone who's clear about reality, why would they want to resurrect a body? That is the question, right? You say, I'll take a light body. Forget about a body of flesh, or even forget about any body at all. I'll take the formlessness. But if for some reason that was the way things were best suited, you could rest a body if you wanted to. It's all pretense anyway. It's just a dream. You can dream anything you want to. You can dream of resurrecting a body. Sure, why not? If you want to, but why would you want to do that? You can also dream of manifesting a body if you want to. If you want to appear here, you can manifest a body if you wanted to. Or if there's someone in the world who wanted you to do that, and drop the pretense of the necessity of birth. There's no necessity of entering the world through birth or through the process of youth or any of that stuff. Again, the whole thing is just a pretense. It's a pretend. It's an imagining. It's a hypothetical scenario. No reality to it whatsoever. None of it. So can teachers appear to people? Of course they can. Of course, if you don't have any objections to it, they can manifest an appearance. Do you need to get sick and die? No, not if you don't want to. Can you turn your body into a light body? Of course you can. You can do anything you want to in the dream, you know. But pragmatically, you know, there's also pragmatic stuff and various things about other people's expectations, et cetera, that come into play in some regard. But all that stuff is secondary. All the talk about gurus and miracles, that's secondary to the deeper situation of you standing up to belief. Okay, your own situation, your practical situation where you're at right now, and the tools that you need to use to say later, we'll deal with, you know, this demand you have right now later. And the belief will say, well, I'm going to have stronger demands. Well, say, we'll deal with those stronger demands later. And we'll deal with whether or not you have the right to charge more interest later or demand more investment later. We'll deal with those demands later, a little later, not right now. And you have to employ that, because if you don't, belief's gonna get you. You know, it's gonna demand your investment now, especially now in this world. Belief is going to all its investors saying, hey, you gotta ante up big time, because this is it. This is belief's big boost is coming, and so we need truth's big boost also to arrive, and I expect it will. I've always expected it will. And there needs to be maturity. There needs to be a certain level of maturity about the whole situation, so, you know, it can take place. Otherwise, it might get scared, you know, and think, oh, belief, because belief's going to be screaming at us and saying, you're hurting your karmic payment schedule, you know, this is interfering. But if you know you don't have any karma, there's no such thing as karma, then you won't be bothered by it. To the extent that you can put belief off, you can be really helped right now. You can receive a true big boost of truth, the big boost of truth. You can receive it to some extent. And I believe that these videos, well, I know these videos to some extent, I don't know what extent, are giving a boost, are part of the big boost. Maybe an echo of it, some kind of faint echo, or some such, maybe not so faint echo of it. It can be much more, though. But if you, to the extent that you're able to stand up to the bully of belief by using the tactics I've described, not now, later, a little later, you can receive, you know, more and more and more and more of the big boost, really. I expect I'll receive a lot. Because I'm at the point now of recognizing this, that I never had any karma. No such thing as karma. Nobody has any karma. And the whole thing's nothing but a pretense. And not feeling like I'm going to upset belief. Doesn't matter how much I upset belief, really. You know, belief will say, you're causing incredible bad karma for yourself. I say, no, I'm not. I'm just giving you pretense to say this. You know, but who cares about pretense in the first place, right? Who cares about, you know, causing pretense? What are you really causing? Nothing at all. So who cares about causing more of nothing, you know? Why should I worry about causing more of nothing, you know? Doesn't matter. Change the causal agent. Doesn't arise at nothing, doesn't arise at all. More of nothing doesn't arise at all. So my expectations are very high. They haven't been fulfilled yet, but because I wasn't ready for it, probably wasn't ready. I expect quite quite a significant big boost at this point. Yeah, I'm starting to look, work through the scarcity thing. That's been a problem with me because belief says, well, if you're not paying now, I want evidence that you're willing to pay. And so I want, and the evidence that I'm willing to pay in the future is that I'm suffering scarcity right now. And belief says that you know, when I said, okay, not now, later, this is very important. So I hope you've hung in here to this point because we're getting to the pragmatic aspects of it. Very important. When you say not later to belief, not now, later, we'll discuss the whole thing later. Belief will say, I want evidence to show that you're giving me this later in good faith. In good faith. And you say, okay, well, what evidence? He says, I want to show you to show me you're willing to give what you say you're going to give later. I say, well, I didn't say I was going to give later. I said I was going to discuss it later. But he says, well, I want good faith. You're going to, this whole discussion thing, this later thing isn't good faith. And you say, okay, what do you want? And then belief will say, I want you to be in a situation where the payment, the investment, will where I feel that you will be in a position that you're going to make it, that payment, that investment. And then you say, okay. Well, there's a problem with that, which is what I'm experiencing when I'm in a terrible situation as far as scarcity goes. Very bad situation all the way around. So, but I'm realizing I'm in this situation to show my good faith to belief that I'm going to make the payment, you know, of what? Death, suffering, trauma, misery. Because I'm in a situation where the rug could be pulled out from under me very easy. When it would, total collapse, you know. I'd be, you know, on the street, literally. I don't have anything. I don't have any future. I don't have assets, nothing. I've been willing to show my good faith. I've accepted this terrible situation that if the rug was pulled out from underneath me, poof, you know, I would make all these payments to belief. All these investments would be made. So that's showing my good faith to belief. But in seeing through this whole situation, I'm not bound by that anymore. I don't have to be bound by scarcity, by this very insecure situation I've been in for so long. And belief will say, hey, you know, I don't think you're operating in good faith anymore. And I say, well, we'll discuss about that whole thing about good faith also later on too, you see. So I may be able to get myself out of this precarious situation. I've been skating on thin ice for a long time because belief demanded of that me as a show of good faith. I haven't broken through the ice, you know, but it's very thin ice, actually. As a matter of fact, coming up within weeks or even sooner, the ice may get too thin for me. And it may break through. I may break through the ice and fall into the icy, chilly water, you know, which is what belief wants me to do. I just said I'm not ready to do it yet. But it says, okay, I want you to fall in that icy, cold water, freezing water, and freeze to death. And I want evidence you're going to do it. So I've been skating on this thin ice, very thin ice. And so belief looks at it and says, okay. It's easy to make that ice a little thinner and boom, he'll fall in. So, okay, that's a show of good faith. I wanna be in good faith, right? Because belief doubts my good faith. So I may be able to turn this around, finally, you know. It's looking like ideologically, conceptually, clarity-wise and truth-wise, there's a path to change that, which would be a great thing. Great thing, because I'd be more helpful to the world if that was the case. Because right now I'm on super thin ice, which is not good. It's not good. So I'm gonna have to look into that, and I could do it now. You know, as a matter of fact. And I just have to say to belief, look, this whole thing of accusing me of bad faith, I'll you know, that's something that I will discuss with you later. And I don't have to agree with belief one way or the other. I say, well, you've got your opinion. Let's say I was put in a better situation where I wasn't skating on such thin ice. And belief will say, hey, I think that, you know, you're showing some bad faith there. Maybe you're not going to pay me. And I say, well, we'll discuss this whole issue of you thinking I'm in bad faith and not going to pay you, etc. We'll discuss that a little later. The whole thing, whatever you want to discuss, we'll also discuss that whole thing about bad faith. Because the truth is, who's operating in bad faith? It's belief that's operating in bad faith, demanding payment, investment in a process that will never reach its goal, that is futile, demanding investment in futility. So that's the very definition of bad faith. So it's belief that's operating in bad faith. So why should I try to convince belief that I'm the one who has to operate in good faith? No, the good faith is to choose a new idea, and I am operating in that, absolutely. So when I get to the situation of turning around the scarcity situation I've been in, you know, the big boost, I'll be able to be more effective for sure, much more effective. That's the one that has got me pinned down. Because I didn't want belief to claim I was operating in bad faith, because then I think the whole I'd have to, you know, explain the whole situation to it, stand up to it entirely at that point. Well, I'm ready to do that. I'm willing to say, hey, you know, you're out of luck, belief. I don't have any karma. Never did. I don't have to invest in futility anymore. So the issue of good or bad faith is not even an issue. It's not even an issue. It's an issue of choice. My choice, not yours. You know, not belief's choice. So it would be truly tremendous to get this scarcity situation off my back. It will be tremendous. And it's starting to come into focus right now, just in the nick of time, I'm telling you. The ice has been getting very thin and thinning more and more and more, to the point now where there's hardly any ice at all. And it's like, I realize, if I keep skating along, boom, into the chilly water. Yeah, wants me to freeze to death, really, is what belief wants me to do, is wants me to freeze to death as payment for some, you know, investment in its plan, and as paying off some karma. I almost did freeze to death when I was younger. I was trying to get to a very warm place, and I thought, I believed I was going to get to a beautiful warm place, and a freak storm came up, and went in the wrong direction, went up to higher elevations, where there was snow, and then a storm hit, and all intents and purposes, I would have frozen to death. I was right on the verge, and unfortunately, the one that was with me, I was with someone, and he saved my life, absolutely saved my life. And because he had a higher tolerance for cold than I did, I got super hypothermia, and I was shaking so bad I had could not function. Could not function at all. It's horrible. So that's what belief wants me to do. I know that. That's the payment it's demanding of me. And I'm in a situation now where theoretically, even this winter, you know, who knows, but that's what it's aiming for, is to get me to freeze to death, being homeless, penniless, out in the elements and freezing to death. So it's interesting to know how belief wants you to die ahead of time. I already know that. And I say, not now, later. Later to that plan. Of course, if I'm in a good situation where I cannot freeze to death, you know, belief's going to say, hey, it doesn't look like you give me evidence you're not going to pay. And I say, well, we'll discuss this whole situation about your doubts about me and blah, blah, blah. We'll discuss it later. The whole thing. All your concerns, your demands, etc. We'll discuss it later, you see. So it's a great day for me to see the stuff I'm telling you. You know, to see the scarcity thing is great, because I've never seen it clearly before. It just shows you that if you make an effort, you can do it. Right now is a great time. You can even see the death that belief is demanding of you. You can even see that ahead of time. I've always been terrified of the cold. Hate the cold, you know. Oh boy, scared of it. Because I know, deep down I know that's what belief wants of me. That's why I stay away from the cold situations. Very much so. It's interesting on that, when I almost froze to death, I was trying to get to a place where there's no cold, a very warm place, a desert place, you know. But I started out real high elevation, and I took a wrong turn and went up higher elevation, you see. Got off track, because I didn't have a clear trail down to it. I was just freewheeling it. Amazing. This whole situation is this whole situation of pretense is can be seen through. It really can be seen through. And Ananda Maima says she saw everything, every aspect of pretense. She saw it clearly right now. The whole, all of it. So there's nothing that is not seen to me. So getting a handle on all of this is an echo of the big boost. It's an echo. It means it's getting closer. I couldn't be saying these things if it's not getting closer, for sure. It is getting closer. But also the troubles are getting closer. Your investment that is demanded of you is also getting very close. So, you know, we have to come through, you know, in a timely fashion here. The big boost has to come in a timely fashion because belief is going to come knocking at your door and say, hey, it's payment time, payment time, payment time. And you know what your death is, what you've agreed to, you know, or not agreed to, but what you have stipulated as a possible payment, as a likely payment, let's put it that way. You haven't entirely agreed to it because there's part of you that says no. This may not be on the up and up. You haven't yet thoroughly vetted belief. Okay, so there's some reservations. It's not a done deal yet. It doesn't have to be a done deal because again, you don't have any karma, and you never will have any karma. Remember, this is all a pretense on the problems that you're supposedly going to have in the future. And you'll never reach that point in the future where you graft, separate cause and effect and graft it. You'll never do that. So you'll never have these problems. So you don't need to know some way to fix these problems or pay off these problems or debts or something you'll accrue in the future. It'll never happen. It will never happen. So you don't need to know how to pay off karma because you'll never have any. You'll never have any. And if you come across someone who has certitude in that, which I know someday I will, in maybe here in the flesh, actually, you know, that's a great day to look forward to. It's a great day to look forward to. And that day could be coming quite soon, actually. So hang in there, you know, hang in there, hang in there, hang in there. And tell belief, not now, a little later. Just say, not now, a little later. Because you're catching the wind, you're catching the breeze of freedom here. And you're saying, hey, wait a minute, wait a minute. Wait just a minute, belief. Not so fast. Not so fast. All right. I told you it's a great day. It's a great day. Every day is a great day. Every day is an even greater day. Right now, every day is even better. Fantastic. All right. Very great. Looks like I got it all here. A lot of things, interruptions and electronic stuff was happening and all this kind of stuff. But you just keep going, right? Say, not now. Not now, interruption. We're talking real business here, important stuff. All right, that's it for this video.